York, J.K. Rowling is famously secretive, but she's also very good at leaving breadcrumbs. So when it comes to discussing Fantastic Beasts 2, I've divided this video into two categories. The first is what we definitely know about the sequel, and then the second is what we need to know based on the clues left for us, not only in things that J.K. Rowling has said when discussing the sequel, but from the movie, the first movie itself. And as always, there are chapter times noted in the video description if there's something you need to know right now. But first, let's talk about what we definitely know. What's confirmed for the sequel? Well, obviously the release date is pretty set, and that is for November 16th, 2018. 18. So they like this positioning for these films, these Fantastic Beasts films, right before Thanksgiving, but we have to wait 2 years for the sequel. This isn't unusual for Harry Potter films. Sometimes we get a bonus and they come 1 year after the next, but there have been 2 year gaps before. J.K. Rowling has finished the screenplay, not to say it can't be tweaked depending on the box office performance of Fantastic Beasts. And then David Yates will return to direct, and in fact, he is committed to directing all 5 Fantastic Beasts movies. Talk about job security. Now, as for the cast, Johnny Depp, of course, is confirmed. It was a big announcement, in fact, that he would be joining Fantastic Beasts 2. And if you've seen Fantastic Beasts 1, you know that's because he makes an appearance in the film. And there is no way they could have kept that secret for very long anyway. But when he's taken into custody at the end of Fantastic Beasts, he says, he challenges Makuza, and he says, "Do you really think you can hold me?" And obviously the answer is no, because he's going to show up in the second film. And I think that the whole Fantastic Beasts franchise is really going to show Grindelwald's rise to power. You can see he's an extremist group, a faction of wizards, but getting a number of followers as he tears through Europe and in the United States secretly in Fantastic Beasts. But of course, he's also working towards that epic showdown with Dumbledore that's already part of Harry Potter lore, which will probably be the 5th movie. So is Grindelwald the B or A storyline or C storyline when it comes to Fantastic Beasts? Well, that all relies on Eddie Redmayne's Newt Scamander and how much he sees himself getting involved. And Eddie Redmayne is confirmed for the sequel. You know, in my spoiler review for Fantastic Beasts, I said, I'm kind of done with Newt Scamander. I don't know if I need to stay with this character. He's pretty passive and he's not a very aggressive, you know, so he's not a very aggressive character. Not a lot going on with him. Or maybe still waters run deep. But I think that he is going to find himself in the middle of the Grindelwald debacle for 2 personal connections, all right? Also, he's a world traveler for work and, you know, personal reasons, as we're about to discuss. So that's another way that, that's a fun way to show Grindelwald's rise to power and that Eddie Redmayne's Newt Scamander just happens to be at certain points of history, or wizarding history. But is it an accident that he's there? Because don't forget that he knows Dumbledore. As it was said in the first Fantastic Beasts movie, there was a move to kick him out of Hogwarts, and Dumbledore supported him. He stood up for him, and as Percival Graves said, "Why does Dumbledore like you so much?" Now, Newt Scamander said, "I don't know, but maybe he felt it was not of Percival Graves' business, or maybe he will find out in a future movie." I have another reason why Eddie Redmayne's Newt Scamander might approach Dumbledore, which we're going to discuss in the What We Need to Know section. It involves Dumbledore's sister. But anyway, the other person that we know that Newt Scamander knows is Leta Lestrange, who we only see a photo of in the first Fantastic Beasts film. But it is confirmed that Zoe Kravitz will actually have speaking lines and appear in the film herself, although it is a moving photo in Fantastic Beasts 1, but that she will be in the sequel. Now, Paris is a confirmed location, or at least, you know, it'll be either the whole movie will take place in Paris or some scenes will take place in Paris. And Lestrange is a French surname, so it makes total sense that the Lestrange family is based out of Paris. And it's also interesting because Zoe Kravitz is an actress of color. This might be our first on screen, at least. I don't know Harry Potter lore maybe as well as some of you Potterheads, but you know, we could have our first you know, magic family of color in the Harry Potter universe. So that could be very interesting. But, you know, a lot of people are making a big deal about Leta Lestrange because, of course, one of her ancestors is Bellatrix Lestrange, who you know quite well from the Harry Potter movies. Now, I want to clarify that even though Lestrange, one of the reasons people say that they have that surname is because there's a history of mental illness in their family. So apparently Leta Lestrange is not just a taker, but a crazy taker. But Bellatrix Lestrange, even though she totally plays into that rumor of mental illness, she is only a Lestrange by marriage. She's actually of the Black family. So I guess maybe they should all stop practicing the dark arts because it seems to lead to mental illness in these families. Because well-known families in the Potter universe are the Blacks, the Lestranges, and the Malfoys. And not only are they well-known for practicing the dark arts, are they infamous for that, but also their pureblood families. Now, I think that could lead to the Lestranges having a connection to Grindelwald and supporting him and his rise to power in Europe. They support the dark arts, and also as a pureblood family, they perfectly play in to Grindelwald's anti-Muggle, anti-Nomad feelings, right? That's what he's advocating. Because he also, don't forget, Grindelwald feels that wizards should rule just regular humans. So I could see the Lestranges really maybe even perhaps hiding Grindelwald so Newt Scamander could accidentally find himself crossing paths with Grindelwald in that capacity. So Leta Lestrange, Albus Dumbledore, two routes for Newt Scamander to find himself crossing paths with Grindelwald yet again. Now, speaking of Dumbledore, he is also confirmed for the sequel, and casting is currently underway. Now, while David Yates is taking suggestions, J.K. Rowling has said that she has a specific actor in mind, which she doesn't want to name unless they get him. And I have to say, I saw somebody say that in a comment section that Jared Harris would be a good choice, and that's who their money is on, that J.K. Rowling wants for the role. And I have to say, upon hearing it, it makes total sense. Now, the best reason that it makes total sense is that Jared Harris's father, Richard Harris, was the very first Dumbledore in the first two movies before he tragically passed away. Michael Gambon only assumed the role afterwards. So that makes perfect sense that his son, Jared Harris, who is a very well-respected actor at this point, would take over the role. Now, you've probably seen Jared Harris in a number of different places. I've interviewed Jared Harris. He is a sweetheart. But the most recent place you might have seen him, you might know him from Mad Men and also as Moriarty in the second Sherlock Holmes Robert Downey Jr. movie. But he's currently on Netflix's The Crown as King George VI, the father of Queen Elizabeth. And he just does absolutely a fantastic job. And he has so much heart that you can just see he has a wonderful disposition to be Harry Potter's future mentor and also to handle the emotional turmoil that Dumbledore is going to go through dealing with Grindelwald. So I think that's a very good chance that's J.K. Rowling's choice. It would be my choice, and it would be a wonderful thing for Jared Harris's career. And such a nice thing considering his father originated the role. All right, so that's what we know about, well, that last one I fudged it a little bit because we don't know for sure who's playing Dumbledore. But now we're going to go to what we need to know based off of what, again, J.K. Rowling has said, what she's hinted at, and the actual first film. So the very first question is, will each Fantastic Beasts movie take place in a different global city? I think that's a fabulous idea. What a way. It's like a Wizarding World tour. What a great way to establish, and also considering the global movie marketplace these days, you would appeal to everyone, but what a great way to establish what the Wizarding community is like the globe over, right? So the first movie takes place, of course, in New York City, then Paris, and then maybe we could head to other cities across the globe. Probably like the big ones that you always hear about, I can imagine. And also I would think about the box office, right? So Russia's a big box office. You can see a movie perhaps taking place there. Also, let's see here, there's the Asian market, obviously, so you could probably see one movie taking place in China, and then perhaps you might, for the final movie, I don't think they have specified where the battle between Grindelwald and Dumbledore takes place. I would imagine Europe, so perhaps somewhere near where Grindelwald went to school. So that would be very interesting indeed. It's not so much Fantastic Beasts and where to find them, but perhaps where to find Grindelwald. All right, so the next question. Is Credence truly dead? I thought he was dead, but many of you have pointed out to me that there's a snippet of the Obscurus that escapes, that catches Newt Scamander's eye, and he does, of course, because he's on Credence's side, doesn't tell Macuza about it, because they want him dead. And he's certainly not going to tell Grindelwald either. And because of that, speaking of Grindelwald, perhaps the future movies in this series might also focus on the fight for Credence. Will he go to the good side or the evil side? You know, a competition of Dumbledore and Grindelwald to win his favor. Now, also, I think what's interesting that Newt, they established, and so this is the beauty of J.K. Rowling's writing. It's so subtle. You know, when it occurs to you, you're like, oh, yeah, of course. Good job, J.K. But Newt Scamander has a very strong interest in studying Obscuruses. He has one, of course, in his suitcase. So I think he'd be very interested in studying Credence. So perhaps he will try and help Credence. Maybe he smuggles Credence out of the country, and he will take him to Dumbledore for training. And then, of course, Grindelwald will still be pursuing him. Because as they said in the first Fantastic Beasts, Credence is a wizard of incredible power to have been able to survive so long with an after having created Obscurus. As they said in the movie, Obscurus usually kills you by the age of 10 or 11. And also, Ezra Miller, I don't think, would have signed on and been so eager to sign. Well, he's a big Harry Potter fan, but he made a big deal about being able to play Credence, and so I don't think he would do that for just one-time appearance. Now, speaking of Obscuruses, there might be a chance that Dumbledore has experience with Obscuruses via his sister, Ariana. And I've seen a couple of people already saying, whoa, did Ariana have an Obscurus? So this is the short history of Dumbledore's sister, Ariana. When she was very young, some muggle boys saw her practicing magic on their property in her backyard. And interested, they snuck in and they demanded she do it again. And when she couldn't, because she didn't have any control of her magic, they beat her up for being a freak. So that traumatized her and left her unable to practice her magic, meaning she pushed it down, and that would create, as Fantastic Beasts illustrates, an Obscurus. Now, this was a very traumatizing situation for the Dumbledore family. Dumbledore's father attacked the boys in retaliation and was sent to Azkaban as a punishment. And then their mother took all three children, Ariana, Albus Dumbledore, and then their other brother, Aberforth, to live in Godric's Hollow. And there was, at one point, a magical explosion, this is what they've said previously, that killed their mother. But it sounds to me like it was an Obscurus, right? So an Obscurus kills Dumbledore's mother, and so Albus Dumbledore becomes his sister Ariana's guardian. And so perhaps he had experiences dealing with Obscuruses. And it was maybe perhaps the Dumbledore family's dark secret. So Ariana actually ended up being killed in a three-way duel between Albus, Aberforth, the two brothers, and Grindelwald. Although perhaps maybe that's a cover, who knows? Maybe they are trying to handle the Obscurus. And come to think of it, maybe that's how Grindelwald knows so much about Obscuruses, and that's why he goes in search of Credence. Perhaps he sees what Ariana's power is and is like, I need me one of those. So fascinating. That would make it sting even more if Grindelwald would use Ariana's death as a stepping stone or a key to unlocking even more power for himself. Then let's go over to nomadges and muggles. How about the Shaw family, which is, you know, why introduce the Shaw family and have John Voight play the patriarch if you're not going to use them going forward, right? So I think pretty clearly we're building up a big conflict between nomadges slash muggles and wizards. So while you have Grindelwald and Dumbledore and Macuza and all that on the wizard side, maybe on the nomadge muggle side, you've got the press. Of course, newspaper headlines are a big part of the storytelling in the Harry Potter, the Wizarding World franchise. So who better to represent the other side than a powerful newspaper magnate? If you don't know what that is, that word, that means a very powerful and influential person in an industry. So Shaw Sr. has all this newspaper at his control, and he has a lot of motivation because one son was killed. You know, his prized son, the senator and perhaps future president, killed violently. They did obliviate everybody at the end of the first Fantastic Beasts movie, but did it make him forget what happened to his son or just what happened at the very end of the movie when the Obscurus Credence was set loose in New York City? And then his other son, don't forget, there's that shot of his other son fascinated by the magic that he sees. And he was interested in the magic story to begin with, and not necessarily in a negative way. So perhaps he's going to be a driving force. Maybe he might be a link and he might be friendly, maybe he found a way to keep dry. You know, maybe not everybody got rained on. So I think the Shaws could become really important going forward. And also, if he pushes an anti-wizard movement with no matches and muggles, that could make it easier for Grindelwald to rally wizards to his side, right? It just would strengthen the conflict. Then, speaking of this conflict of wizards versus nomads slash muggles, one of you pointed out that Goldie and Jacob are a very personal illustration of that, because their relationship, their romance, or potential romance, is not only frowned upon, but it's actually illegal, at least in the United States. You know, Newt Scamander says you have very archaic laws about no intermingling between, basically don't create any half-bloods. So as tensions rise, you could see a really, you know, I think that interracial romance, interreligion romance, J.K. Rowling could really have a really great metaphor for that with Goldie and Jacob as tensions worsen in these movies. So I think that sounds very promising. Then here's an interesting question. What about Newt Scamander's brother? When he's first brought into the discussion there, and he pops out and someone says, Scamander, as you might recall, someone in the room says, the war hero? And it's like, oh no, that's, and so, I think Newt Scamander says, that's my brother. So where is, and this is apparently his name, it's floating around, that his name is Theseus Scamander, and he's a very powerful auror, which is, you know, an investigator. And he actually knows Percival Graves, and he must still be alive if people were asking about him. So he sounds like a pretty interesting character. So will he show up perhaps in a future movie? Then, speaking of Percival Graves, aka Colin Farrell, I think that's our last question for Fantastic Beasts 2 for now, is that, is where is the real Percival Graves? As many have pointed out, the deception only would have worked if Percival Graves was someone these people all knew beforehand. I don't think Grindelwald would be it, but I don't think he had the time to establish a whole career as an auror in the United States for Makuza. So is Percival Graves dead, or is he perhaps imprisoned by Grindelwald? Maybe he and Theseus Scamander are off on a mission and he has no idea he's even being impersonated. I would love for Colin Farrell to return, so I hope that Percival Graves is okay. Maybe he's also evil and said, hey, you want to be me for a while? I'll go on a vacation, you know, that's fine. But I think that there are other, I think J.K. Rowling can do better than that. But as long as she brings back Colin Farrell, I'm good with it. So that's what we know about Fantastic Beasts 2 so far and what we need to know. So write down below your thoughts on the sequel. What do you want to know or need to know about Fantastic Beasts 2? And what do you think of the questions that I've put forward here for the sequel? Write your thoughts down below, and you can check out some more videos right now.